today we are continuing our segment on, or series rather, on Beyond the Signs. And as you know, the whole idea behind the series, and I just found this out yesterday afternoon that I was going to preach this morning or this afternoon, was that the idea behind the series was that Jesus had all these series of miracles. And the whole point of these miracles was not just to hail him as the healer, which is typically what happens to us, rather than realizing who he really is. And those series of revelations or series of miracles were not just to exposit and to prove that God could heal us, but to introduce to us who he really is as the Son of God. And what does that really mean? That's the whole idea behind the series. We looked at the wedding at Cana and how Jesus had that miracle and what that meant to that couple. We looked last week about Jairus and what that meant to him and that miracle. And today we're looking at yet another miracle in John chapter 5, beginning in verses 1 and 2. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool in Aramaic called Bethesda. I actually had the privilege of being to this place. This Pastor Paul and I had stood right where this pool is, and there's a colonnade. There's this five-roofed colonnades. This is actually it's not a small little baptismal pool. This is actually quite a large area. And the depth of this pool is about 45 feet. This is where animals go. It's not a very pleasant place. It was actually where a lot of people went who were ill. The verse says, in these lay a multitude of invalids, lots of people. Literally hundreds of people were there, and they were not the prettiest of people. They were actually sick people, blind, lame, and the paralyzed were gathered here in this place. And so you can imagine the stench, the smell, the picture of this pool, because people actually dove in this thing because they believed at a certain moment when the water started to stir that there was healing that was happening in the water, and whoever jumped in first and got there right at the moment that the water was stirring would be healed, which is literally an urban legend. Nothing about scripture, nothing in the Old Testament had actually spoken of this, but it had become something of a belief that the people believed in because of tradition in that area. Now notice that this was dealing with the helpless. This is a visual peg, if you may, of the situation where you're dealing with helpless people, hopeless people, and if not hapless people. Hapless simply means the unlucky ones. These are the ones that don't really have it all together, and they're all gathered in this area. And now all of a sudden it says that they were waiting. Everybody say waiting. They were waiting for the moving of the water, which is really the problem of the problem. In other words, the problem behind the problem. The problem was not that they were sick. The problem was not that they were helpless. The problem was not even that they were unlucky or hapless. The problem was they were waiting for the solution for something that was the wrong thing they were waiting for. And many times that happens to us. It might not necessarily be a situation of being paralyzed or blind or stuff like that. It could be a dryer, amen? As in my case. I realized I didn't have the money to buy the kind of dryer. I was told that there's only one hope for you, they were telling me. Because of the size of your kitchen and because of the configuration of your window, the only thing you can do is buy a dryer which has a condenser, which is about three times the price of a cheap dryer. Or, Jimmy, you probably know this. And then they said there's the other option is this thing that there's three different options, which is the normal one with the exhaust thingy, which couldn't work because, standing up here, the tube's out there, there's no way out here. It's weird, okay? So the other option is the one without the exhaust, but I've got to buy this thing. It's twice the price. The other one's three times the price. I've got no options, right? So I'm waiting for the wrong thing. But praise be to God, a miracle happened. The option was I can actually invert a dryer. The point is we have options, but we wait for the things that don't happen. Maybe that's not your situation. Maybe your idea is I can solve this problem if I just had the right app. Some of you single people, if I just had the right boyfriend, or the right girlfriend, if I was just waiting for the right stuff, if something just moved in that water that made me, and we're waiting for the answer that sometimes is really not God's answer. Waiting for the wrong thing would be the worst thing that we could ever do. And it's kind of like my feeling about, just get this, I'm turning 60 in a few months, and I'm starting to become a missionary, amen? How many of you know one who just love the experience? And listen, some of you who are slightly older like me, let me give you a message this morning. Don't ever listen to the adage that says you can't teach old dogs new tricks. Okay? Some of you, you're sitting there and you're saying, you know, I'm too old for this thing. I mean, it's not happened to me yet. I don't have that college degree. I don't have that business. I don't have that job. I don't have that pedigree. You are not too old for new tricks. Amen? Just look at me, all of you old people. And some of you who are not very young anymore. Okay? First of all, the reason why you're still good for new tricks is because, number one, you're not a dog. Amen? Some of you, you got to stop this nonsense. You are not as old as you think you are. I'm starting out. I'm actually in honeymoon stage right now. I don't know if you understand this, okay? I'm doing laundry with my missus and starting over. Don't you ever give up on God. Don't you ever think that it's over, it's too late. I mean, I'm too old. I mean, my hair's mine's falling too, amen? But it's okay, okay? It's not about the hair. Stop waiting for the thing that you shouldn't be waiting for. There's something else you should be focusing on and not that thing, basically. Then it says that the angel of the Lord went down. He's basically describing this nonsense, this urban legend, that we're just waiting for this. Basically, he's giving an excuse for the wrong thing he believes. He already believes the wrong thing, and he's justifying why this wrong thing can't even work for him. Do you get this? This is how silly and ridiculous we can be about the things of God. We're already believing the wrong thing, and we've got the perfect excuse why it won't work for us. Because the angel is not there. In other words, this religious legend's not working for me. And if the steer, the water, in other words, it's about this potion and this place is not happening to me. And worst of all, I never get there on time. I'm actually just one of the unlucky ones. By the time I get there, someone else is, it's happening for someone else. Did you ever feel that way, where you've always felt like my situation is not as good as his and his situation is far better than mine, which gives you the excuse? I don't have that app. I don't have that supplement. Since I've been taking a supplement, which I haven't been able to take lately just because of my move and my access to that particular supplement, sometimes we start holding on to these things. And I can't seem to make my system work without this, and we're forgetting that God is beyond any of these things. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly more than we could ever ask or imagine. We've got to focus on Him, not the what, not the why, not the how, but the who is what John was talking about. That there's a place where we've got to go beyond just looking at the formula that we've gotten used to. This is how God moved. This is how God did this thing before. This is how God worked for me before. And God's saying, no, focus on who I am. Because I have options that are far more infinite than you could ever imagine. Now, it says in verse 5, one man. Everybody say one man. In other words, out of all this crowd, God singles you out. He knows what's happening to you, believe it or not. He knows exactly what's going on in your life, and He cares. And he's an invalid for 38 years. In other words, this guy had every excuse to say, this isn't going to happen anymore. I'm too old. I mean, if I needed to have my dream home, that should have happened 15 years ago. If I was to have my dream job, it should have happened years ago. If I was to be this and that, if I were to get married, that should have happened 10 years ago. In other words, it's all these things that limits us where we're declaring it's no longer going to happen because it hasn't happened yet. And yet here in this particular story, Jesus comes and causes the thing to happen. Verse 6, when Jesus saw him laying and knew that there had been there already for that long a time, he said to him, do you want to be healed? And that's a question for you and me. Sometimes when you read that verse, you think how insensitive. Doesn't he know that this guy has been sick for that long and all he wants is to get out of there and be healed? But really, the question was, Jesus was exposing the reality of his heart. Are you just willing to settle for all the excuses? Are you just willing to settle for all your religious beliefs? Or are you still willing for you to expose the very nature and every problem of your heart? Do you still want to believe that there's something beyond? You know, as I've come to Singapore and see where the young people are, the rise of the nuns, so to speak, I'm actually not losing energy. I'm actually not even losing grace. I'm actually not even feeling like it's going to be a hard place. I actually feel recharged, and I actually feel that God's going to give us the wisdom and the ideas to be able to reach these guys in this season of time. And what happens to us is when we're faced with the gamut of the issues that beset us, we become negative, and we begin to backtrack, and we begin to start thinking, maybe I made the wrong decision, maybe I'm doing the wrong thing. And here Jesus is saying, I want to expose your heart. I want to see what is the real issue. Do you really want this to be healed? Some of you are saying, my marriage is not working. And Jesus is asking, do you still want to be healed? Do you still want to fix that thing? Or are you willing to settle and say, this is the way that our marriage is going to be? And Jesus is saying, no, do you want it? Do you want it to be fixed? Or are you saying, no, this is as far as I go? Now the sick man answered him, sir, I have no one to put me in the pool. Basically, he's created a set of excuses for his already sad state of affairs. In other words, bad mistake, believing in the wrong thing, justifying why he's believing the wrong thing, and now he even has a layer of excuses on top of that, justifying why even the bad thing that he believes isn't going to work for him, because no one's there to help me. In fact, by the time I get there, I'm so unlucky, I never get there. Pronouncements of the way we operate our lives and kind of say this is the situation we're in and we're never going to fix it and we're never going to solve it. Now, Jesus said to him, get up, take your bed, and walk. It's interesting. No formulas, no patterns, no go to Bible study first, no go to one-to-one first, no get baptized first, no believe this first, no just get up and walk. And I'll heal you instantly. He said, at once the man was healed and he took up his bed and walked. There's places, folks, when God just wants to be God and just God wants to heal you for who he is, and he's really not looking for you to believe in a formula or a system or a moment of timing. Many of you know that one of the reasons why my move to Singapore was delayed was my father had a stroke. And my father is still at home right now. He's palliative, and we're taking care of him. And the Lord's been gracious to bless us, to be able to take care of him. And that my mother's at peace. But in the midst of being in abroad, the worst thing that can happen to you is to get a call, and you realize that an emergency has happened. And about 2 weeks ago, I received a call from the house, and I was told that my 85-year-old mother, so you got to imagine this, she's 85 years old, she was in the bathroom, and you know how bathrooms are, there's a ledge that's not even, and she made a misstep. And because she made a misstep, she basically fell and hit her ribs and basically fractured four of them. So she had to be rushed to the hospital, she had a pneumonia, and obviously we got the call, and we were told that mom's in the hospital, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we started to think, and sometimes what happens to us is, God, what did I do? We start assessing and thinking, what are the process, what's the formula, rather than just, can God heal my mother right now? Is he capable of that? I remember just holding that phone and talking to my mother and saying, Mom, I'm going to pray for you, and we're going to trust Jesus together. And I prayed for my mother, and the interesting thing was I didn't feel anything, I didn't see anything, but 2 days later I got a phone call and my mom was on her way home because she was well. God is more powerful than you can ever think. It is. Now, please don't get me wrong, my mom is still in pain, okay? My mom still has the pain, she's still kind of swollen, but she no longer has the pneumonia because that's the dangerous one. The point is, God is able. Will you look to him for who he is rather than the what, the why, and how will this work? Just trust him. It's not about the what or about the how, but about the who. It's trusting him. Now, here's the interesting thing. Jesus heals this man completely. The guy gets healed, but the story doesn't end there. We should be celebrating. But the goal was not just to prove that Jesus was the healer. The goal was to reveal something about Jesus, and we find that in verse 9, the second half of verse 9. Now that day was a Sabbath. Now here's where the revelation happens. Jesus heals, there's a miracle, they celebrate, but it doesn't end there. In other words, that day was a Sabbath. Now, let me tell you a little bit of a story about my recent Sabbath, which has something to do with my washing machine. You know what Sabbath is, right? That's Monday for pastors. And that Monday I had preached and ministered. And so Monday I came home. I'd actually lost my keys to the house. This is actually my struggles in this new mission I have are not very big. They're lost keys, they're dryers, there's stuff like that. And my wife had this idea that I might have actually left the keys in my pants. And because it's in my pants, it went to the dryer, and because of the dryer, the keys went inside the machine, and somehow the machine is stuck right now because my keys are inside the washing machine. Are you guys following the story? Right. So my wife, being a good wife and wanting to save money, went on YouTube to look at how to DIY a washing machine. So you know where this is going, right? I mean, just think about this. So this is Marie and Joey camping in Singapore. And my wife all of a sudden wakes up on a Monday morning thinking she's going to find my keys inside the washing machine and she will actually have to dismantle the washing machine, which is fine, okay? I could live with that. What I couldn't live was when she told me that morning that we should go and do it right now, which meant Joey will have to lift the dryer and the washing machine and navigate it out of the kitchen. So as it would, typically, when you've been married as long as we have, which is almost 35 years, when she said, I'm going to dismantle it, and I'm going to find the keys, and I'm going to open the washing machine, my first computation reaction is this is going to be more expensive than the washing machine by getting actually a guy to fix it, number one, because she's going to bust it up. Number two, I might drop this thing on my foot. So she offered, I can't care, honey, take a look. I mean, I'm not Superman, right? I may be dressed in black, but I'm not Batman. Okay. I'm thinking, you actually expect me to carry both of those and navigate it? You saw three people try to install that. And now you want this flimsy little man to move all of that for you so you can dismantle it. Okay? So that was a nice way of saying it, but that's not how I said it. I actually got a little bit, not angry, loud voice, okay? So long story short, she offered, we'll just carry it together. Now I might actually drop this on her foot and now we got to go to the hospital. You know how these work, okay? Your mind starts running amok while you're on a Sabbath day. Okay? This is life's realities, folks. So make a long story short, she gets mad, stomps off, you don't care, typical thing that we fight over. And then so there I am, I'm all alone, I'm convicted, I'm condemned, I'm the bad guy. So what I did now was I actually moved all of that by myself. Okay? Hard to describe, and you don't want to see what I looked like. I had boxes here, and I just had to move everything. Long story short, I get to move the thing. She gets to fix it, and by the way, my wife's a genius. She opened the thing, fixed it. There were no keys, but the machine worked. Okay. It was actually a bunch of my coins inside the machine. Anyway, the point was, after she fixed it, I got the silent treatment for the whole day. But the good news was my wife wrote a blog about it. Now, the beginning of the blog says, what is it? People sometimes ask, do you and Joey ever fight? My answer, hello, is the sky blue. Okay. Yes, we still do. Not about major stuff, but it's minor. So she writes a blog about, you know, basically the incident. And how you got to be clear and how you got to be the chill, okay? The halt your mouth and what was the I forgot, okay? So that was her way of treating it. But in the meantime, I had a problem. This is my Sabbath, and she's not cooking any food, and she's going on a fast. So that means I had to be hard-boiled eggs that day, okay? So I'm giving you life, folks, and how even in this sordid sort of way, God still moves. And I offered her, I said, hey, I'm going to go out and buy some eggs, because I was trying to make her feel guilty, obviously, and I'm going to... And then I, would you like me to buy something for you? He says, no, I'm not eating anything, okay? So I stomp out, and I didn't stomp out. I walked out and in self-pity, dragging that. You know, in Singapore, you got to drive a cart because you don't have a car, so your grocery, you're dragging it around, right? I started to just meditate on Christ. This is true. It's easy to fall into self-pity. It's easy to fall in and lose and want the miracle. Lord, fix her. What's wrong with her? Rather than just, and not even fix me, is your Lord of the Sabbath. You're my God. You'll fix this. You'll figure out a way. We've been inundated with the what, the how, the why, the where. We're forgetting the who. And I walked and bought the eggs and came back and started boiling the eggs in self-pity still, a little bit. But I learned something. Slow it down enough to focus on Jesus. You know, the greatest blessing that I have is I married a Christian, amen? And those of you who are not yet married, men and women, whatever you do, marry a Christian. I'm telling you, okay? All I had to do, my strategy was very simple. I just had to boil eggs and bite my tongue, amen? Boil eggs, bite your tongue, and eat the eggs. And bite your tongue, no matter what happens, because a Christian will eventually be convicted by the Holy Spirit. Okay? So you just have to wait, okay? That's the beautiful thing about it. So whatever you do, okay, marry a Christian. That's the lesson for this message right here. Okay? And true enough, by sunset, after my eighth egg, my wife comes and says, "Sonny, I'm sorry. I'm sorry also." Life's got miracles, folks. And sometimes we're so busy, fix this, fix that, heal this, heal that. God sometimes just wants you to focus on the who. Not the what, not the why, not the where. So the Jews said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath. It's not lawful for you to take up your bed." In other words, basically, these guys are even worse. This guy's working and waiting for something that's urban legend. It's got every reason why it doesn't work and has every excuse why it doesn't work. These guys are even worse. These guys have institutionalized the excuse why it shouldn't work. And by the way, we can be guilty of that as Christians, where we've figured out all the nuts and bolts of why it won't work rather than just trusting that Jesus can basically say, "Get up and walk and I'll make it happen for you." And sometimes it loses the power that God has in that situation. But he answered, the man who, everybody say who. It's not what, how did he do it? No, who healed me. It's who he is. That man said to me, "Take your bed and walk." That's all he did. He didn't do a lot of hocus pocus. He didn't do now. Sometimes Jesus does that, but in this particular case, nothing. Just figure out who. God has infinite resources, options, ideas, people he can send you if you will focus on the who. Infinite. Not unlimited, infinite. There is no stopping what God can do in your situation if you'll focus on who he is rather than what he's going to do, how he's going to do it, when he's going to do it, where he's going to do it. You can simply say, pick up your mat and, who is this man? This is the issue. Who is this man? They can't believe that there's such a person. They can't believe that there's such a God like that. They believe that God is this God of the formula, God of the system, God of the pattern. If you don't do it this way, you won't get it. No, 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 that's not who God is. God can make a way where there is no way. God can turn what you didn't know. You could actually invert dryers, including the panel board, and they still work. You didn't know that, right? He did. Because he knows things you don't. Now, the man who had been healed did not know who it was. He didn't know who Jesus was. There's that who again. Afterwards, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you are well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you." And this is the crutch, the very essence, the crux of this message. Jesus is not just the healer. He's the Savior. And he's saying basically, sure, you're now walking. Imagine, this is 38 years. Think about a guy who hasn't walked for 2 years and that muscle shrinks. This is 38 years and there's a miracle and he walks. And Jesus said, you know, as great as that is, that's nothing. Because ultimately you will still die. And the worst thing that can happen to you is not for you to get sick. The worst thing that can happen to you is to not realize that you're in sin and you're headed for eternal damnation. The worst thing that can happen to you is to focus on that dream thing, that dream job, that dream house, that dream spouse, that dream idea, that dream vacation, and miss out and actually get it and miss out on the real problem. And he said that nothing worse may happen to you. What else? What could be worse that can happen to you when you've already been healed of something that's impossible? It's to miss out on the idea of eternal life. That as you fade through the limelight and as you lose more energy, the fact of the matter is God's miracles are still with you and will be with you forever. The man went away and told the Jewish leaders, this time with boldness, who Jesus was and who made him well. Because now he understood it wasn't about just the healer. It wasn't just about the healing. It's about who he is. And this was the way why the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the side. It's a ridiculous thing. They were persecuting him more because he was doing things in a way that was not their formula. Finally, but Jesus answered them, my Father is working until now, and I'm still working. Isn't that the greatest consolation, the greatest thing you could ever know, is whatever happens to you, wherever you are, whatever your situation is, Jesus and the Father is working for you. Let me close this story by telling you why I'm here. I'm supposed to be here next week. We were coming home for the discipleship convergence, but a few days before we came home, I bit something and I cracked my crown. See, I've got an amazing dentist who fixed my crown and it's just indestructible. I can practically not destroy it. And I've forgotten that that thing existed. I actually thought I had a healthy tooth there, not realizing I had a crown. So I bit on it and I cracked. Now, I think you understand what that means. Those teeth are alive, so I was in huge pain. I got my half of my face was in pain and my wife had left and I was laying hands on my face believing what happened to my mother will happen to me. Okay? And I said, Lord, heal this tooth. And by 3:30 in the evening, the pain was getting worse. And at this point, there's no drugstores open and I'm believing God. I'm crying out to God and believing that what he did for my mother, he would do for me, and it didn't happen. So the next day, I took pain relievers and I told the staff, I've got to go home. I've got to get this fixed. Long story short, I get to the dentist. I'm told I'm going to have four meetings. I don't want to call it anything other than that. And they're going to be like 3-4 hours each. And they're going to have to drill through it. I don't want to cause you pain. I'm just citing the example to you. And I'm going to close this message very soon. My first day was last Friday, and I was sitting in the chair, and they've removed the cap. It took 2 hours to remove it from 2 o'clock to 2:45 or something. And then they started to clean up the tooth. And my wife, my beautiful wife, texted me. And she said, hi, sweetie, how are you? I'm sitting in the chair. This is now 4:41, which is now 2 hours and 41 minutes into the ordeal. And I responded by saying this, ayoko na uwi na ako. Okay. That's in English. Is I'm done here. I'm going home. And my wife said, "You're a brave boy. Thank God we have a very good dentist." This is what happens when you've been married this long. Okay, you start talking this way to each other. And I respond by saying, "I'm a knight, but I want to go home to Vito so he can protect me." And she responded by saying, "He will guard your mouth. Are you still being a knight?" And I said, "Yes, but I want to hug Vito." So the final message was this: brush your teeth, Papa. I'm dazed now, okay? I'm dazed, I'm dizzy, I'm tired. I get out, use the bathroom, come back, and I'm waiting for my son's driver, and I'm walking outside. I get in the car, I'm about to get out of the parking lot, say, sir, we have to pay the parking lot, and I find out and I realize I don't have my wallet. And so all these pictures of my wallet's gone, I'm dead. My keys, my house keys, now it's no longer in the washing machine, it's with the burglar now. My license, my credit cards, my money, everything's gone. And I'm running back to the dentist. Ran to the janitor, did you find my wallet? Did you find my wallet? Did you find them? I'm panicking now. Ran back to the coffee shop. Ran and I said, Maria, I can't find it. Check all the garbage cans. So I went to all the garbage cans and checked everything. They may have taken your wallet. They threw away your wallet and you might be there. By now it's 8 o'clock, 8:30. I haven't found anything. Talked to everybody in the building. Boarded the car. We're about to go home and I'm depressed, basically. And I remembered that idea of the Sabbath, of pausing and not allowing your mind to run amok. And this thought hit me. Jesus knows where your wallet is. And I began to slow down and I started to think about that. Jesus knows exactly where my wallet is. He's in control of the situation. If he needed that wallet to get to me right now, it will be back with me. If it had to land with somebody else who needed the money, he'll use it for him. If he needed that guy to meet me so he gets it saved, he'll do it. Whatever happens, Jesus knows where my wallet is. Okay? And all of a sudden, the peace of God began to surround me. Sometimes we move too fast. We start imagining and conjuring ideas of the worst things that can happen to us. This driver pulled up. I just got led by the Holy Spirit and said, could you stop for a while? Let me just check the car one more time. We checked the car one more time and it's not there. Shut the door, put my hands, put out the belt. As soon as I put my hand, the wallet is right there beside me. Did I leave it there? Did I drop it there? I have no idea. What I do know is this. It's the who. Not the what, not the how, not the why, not the where, the who. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, when we allow our problems to run ahead of us, our minds run amok. We begin to imagine bad things. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, our minds are stayed. Our minds remain calm. And God's able to move in our lives. Amen? You stand on your feet as we close in the word of prayer. Just close your eyes, bow your heads, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you. Just be still before Him right now. Look up here for a minute. Prayer is declaring that God, you have the answers and the options for my life. Meditation is putting a stop to your vain imaginations, whether good or bad. Prayer is saying, God, I know who you are. And I'm making a declaration that I'm not starting this day without you. Meditation is curtailing the wrong things that your mind wanders through. Secret to that is who? God of the universe. You know our situations. You know our desperate needs. You know our issues. You know our length of life in this earth. And we give you all the trust. Would you just lift up your hands towards heaven this morning, this afternoon rather. Father, thank you for your holy word. And Father, the simple message of this verses, it's not the why, the timing, it's not our ideas, it's not our experiences, it's not what we've learned in the past, God. At the end of the day, it's about who you are. Jesus, thank you that the greatest, the worst thing that can happen to us is that we live in sin and be separated from you. And if that's been addressed, we can trust that the best is yet to come. Father, I pray for those of us, Lord, who are advancing in age, that you would even show us, Lord, there are new horizons, new dreams, new things, new opportunities, new goals that you want us to achieve. I pray, Father, that you silence the voice of the enemy, silence the voice of accusation, silence the voice of discouragement, but we would embrace fully the voice of our God who says, take up your bed and walk. Take up your bed and walk. Father, whatever is hindering us, whatever is stopping us, whatever things we may have not had in the past, we trust you can make a way. And Lord, we just praise you, we honor you, and we bless you this day. And in your name, Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen and amen.